Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord,
everybody.
Praise the Lord.
God is great. Amen. Isn't he wonderful?
Yes.
He is wonderful. We are so blessed to have you in service today with us. Tell your neighbor, I'm so happy you're here today.
Hostess, I said, need a wheelchair. I said, you don't mind? She said, okay. So they ordered me a wheelchair, and I got on this wheelchair, and this lady, she come walking down. She grabbed the wheelchair, and she took me on the top of the stairway, and she did not call me honey. She did not say sweetheart. She did not say darling. She took one look at me and she said, Uncle! To you and your wonderful pastor. How many appreciate the pastor and his wife and his children? How many would vote for your pastor for the next 12 months? Raise your hand. If you didn't vote for your pastor, then we'll want to see you in the office. We're glad to have Pastor Gray and his wife starting a new work in Nanakoo. Everybody say, praise the Lord. I got to believe that when the trumpet sounds, when the Lord comes back for his church, church that you and I belong to, the born again church, the true church, when that trumpet sounds on that day, or that night, whatever it might be, the Bible said that the dead in Christ shall rise first. Amen. We which are alive and remain will be caught up together. Hallelujah. I believe there will be saints coming from Waianae, saints from Nanakuli, saints from Texas, saints from all over the world when the Lord comes back. Pentecostal Sunday, I want to read to you a few scriptures that you're very familiar with. Everybody say Pentecostal Sunday. Pentecostal is not a religion. It is an experience with God. You see, you can be religious and be lost. But brother, when you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, when he comes into your life and he fills you with the Spirit of Almighty God, hallelujah, you're a different person. Hallelujah, in Jesus Christ. Praise the name of the Lord. You have your Bibles? I'm reading from the second. You can sit down. You don't have to get up. Let me stand up, okay? And when I sit down, you can get up. Right? The second chapter of the book of Acts. Yeah. How many brought your Bible? Yeah. How many didn't bring your Bible? We want to see you in the office too. Praise the Lord. Is it a Pentecostal Bible? Yeah. We don't want the Book of Mormon. We don't want the Jehovah's Witness. We don't want Mary Ann and Baker Patterson, keys to the scripture. We want the real word of God. Right? Praise the Lord. Acts, the second chapter. Acts, the second chapter, setting up the first verse. And when the day of Pentecost, everybody say Pentecost.
Pentecost.
Was fully come.
Yeah.
They were all with one accord in one place.
Yeah.
In the city of Jerusalem. Everybody say Jerusalem.
Jerusalem.
How many people, Brother Katimo, the first church had 120 people? That's right. That's what they started off with. And whether you know it or not, let me tell you this. Mary, everybody. Everybody say Mary.
Mary.
The mother of Jesus Christ. She was among the 120. So when you talk to a Catholic person, they exalt Mary up here. Jesus Christ is below. You tell that Catholic person, did you know that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was there on the day of Pentecost?
Yes, sir.
She was baptized in Jesus' name.
Yes.
And she received the Holy Ghost. Speak it in tongues. Praise the Lord. Second verse. And suddenly there came a sound from where? Not Honolulu. Not Kahuku. Not Kilimanjaro. But all the way. Everybody say, from heaven. As of a rushing mighty wind,
yes.
And it filled all the house where they were sitting. Verse 3, and there appeared unto them cloven tongues, like as a fire on each of them. Verse number 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost,
yes.
Or the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
The only way that you can say that you have received the Holy Ghost is that you will have the evidence of speaking in tongues. If somebody tell you, I think I've got the Holy Ghost, well, I don't know when I've got the Holy Ghost, then you never got the Holy Ghost. Because when you receive the Holy Ghost, there is an evidence.
Yes.
You see, Mother Cathedral, do you have any money? Well, not a whole lot, but I do have 2 pennies. Do you have any money? Yes, I got any money. Where's the evidence? Well, don't you believe it? God don't believe you. Where's the evidence? Two cents? That's the evidence.
That's right.
Did you receive the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
How did you know you received the Holy Ghost? What's the evidence? Because when you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, according to the Bible, they all spoke in tongues. As the Spirit of God gave them utterance. Everybody say praise the Lord. Time to sit down and take a drink.
Yeah.
I want to speak to you today on my personal experience.
Amen.
Of what we call Pentecost.
Amen.
And I want to speak to you from my heart. Everybody say, from your heart.
From your heart.
You see, when I was a young man, going to what we call junior high or elementary school, 7, 8, and 9, the school was called Quantum Core. It's still there. And I went 3 years off my junior high or 7, 8, and 9th grade. My young teenager days. By the way, I'm 82 years old. I get up in the morning and I look myself in the mirror. And Pastor, it's a terrible sight. I can't believe it's me. No wonder sometimes the mirror cracks. Something so ugly, I guess. And when I was going to my intermediate high school, I fell in love. away. Oh, hallelujah. And she and I used to correspond to one another. She didn't have a telephone. I had a telephone that lived by Punch Bowl, and she lived in Khalid, and I guess her parents wouldn't afford. So we would correspond, we would write letters. Can you imagine? Living on the same island, writing the airmail letter, and she would write to me. Now, I thought of all the girls in the school, I thought, man, she is the most beautiful looking Filipino girl. So we would write letters to each other. And I would close my, we call it love letters, or we call it, everybody say, puppy love. She would write to me, and I would close, and I would say, her name was, I still remember her name, was Lenora. Everybody said, Lenora.
Lenora.
I would write her and say, Lenora, sweetheart.
Sweetheart.
I love you. Everybody say, love you.
Love
you. Lenora. With everything that I got, body, soul, and spirit, I love you with everything that's within me. And so I want to relate to you my journey of what we call living for God, or what we call Pentecost. This coming December the 24th, 2017, Lord willing, I will celebrate and commemorate 62 years of being saved. It's not what we profess to have, but it is what we claim to have. I am what I am because of the grace and the mercies of God. You are what you are, not because of your nationality, not because of the money that you have, not because of the material things that we have possessed, but we are what we are by the grace of Almighty God. I got up 16 months ago in the town that I lived in, Silver Lake, Texas. It's a small town. It's one horse town. No, maybe they got two horses. It's what they call in Japanese a squishy town. Squishy. It's very tiny town, because you got a stoplight, and then you got a sign, welcome to Silver Lake. On the same side, on the other side, it says, aloha. Small town. I got up to use the bathroom early in the morning, and something happened. I couldn't move my arm. I couldn't move my leg. I called my daughter and son-in-law, which is about 15 minutes away. They called an EMS. I went to their house the next same day. I went to the emergency room. The doctor said, Mr. Cardigo, you had a slight heart attack. I had no idea. that bad. I never smoked. I never drank. I never did drugs. I'm not saying that because of that, but I try to watch my health. And so they took a thorough examination of this physical body I've had all these years. And they came out and they told my family, according to our readings, there's blockage 100% on one side. There's another blockage of 80% on the other side. And they said, we do not understand why your father is still alive. You say, oh, Brother Kajibo, you were just fortunate. You say, Brother Kajibo, you were just lucky. No. We believe in Jesus Christ. We don't believe in good luck or bad luck. We believe in the blessing of the Lord. Highly blessed. They did a quadruple full operation on my heart. Not one, not two, not three, not four all in my heart. And I ran to rehab and I came out with flying colors and I say, thank you, Jesus. That loves you, it's not because of good luck, you're blessed.
Amen.
If you have a husband that goes out and work and make a living, they bring the little pig and the boy and the paku and the enchilada, the kimchi. Washington. He said, next time I see you, I'll be 100 years old. I don't know whether he's going to live or not that long. I go to meet a lot of Bogoong, and you might live 200 years old. I graduated from high school in 1953. Yeah. Some of you folks wasn't even born. Some of you folks were just thought about it. McKinley High School. McKinley High School. All the Japanese went to McKinley High School. All the Hawaiians went to Kamehameha. All the Harris went to Punahou. All the Portuguese, this is my time, I'm talking about my time now, went to Roosevelt High School. All the Filipinos that live in Kalihi and in Waipahu went to Fredericton. Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
After I graduated, I was at college material. I didn't make good grades, A's and B's, and I think my grade was D and D plus. I barely made it. So the only way we can get out of Oahu on the Hawaiian Islands is to join the military. So all of my brothers joined the army. And I said, if I join the army, I'm going to train in Schofield Barracks. Born and raised in Schofield Barracks in the island, I want to go to what they call the mainland, the big place on the beach. So I thought I'd be a smart aleck, and I joined the Marines! And when I told my brother that I joined the Marines, he gave me a long lecture. We left Pearl Harbor, we arrived in San Francisco, and they flew us to a place called San Diego, California. Whole bunch of local boys. A lot of them never left the island. So about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, the Marines are real nice. They get you up in the morning. And at night, they put you to bed. They tell you what to eat. They tell you when to take a shower. And I'm not used to all this, you know. Because we never did back home. But Brother Katiba, you're not back home. You ain't the Marines now. So we all standing up there, what they call formation. And they're calling your name. And here I am, young Filipino local boy, never been away from home. 2, 3 o'clock in the morning at San Diego. You can't see because it's all foggy outside. And it's cold. I'm shivering. I'm saying to myself, what am I doing over here? There must be a mistake somewhere. And they call it, everybody say, boot camp.
Boot camp.
And the reason why they call it boot camp, because they boot you a lot. I spent 4 years in hard labor, none of it. They sent me overseas when I got there. I spent a year in Japan. Yes. Everybody says Japan.
Japan.
Beautiful. Mama San would say, Boy San, it's Kose. Japanese, eh? No, I ain't no Japanese. I'm from Hawaii. I'm what they call Filipino. Filo who? So after a year, they sent me to Korea. All together different from Japan. After Korea, I came home with the first division of a base was in Camp Pelton, California. I wasn't in the church yet. I wasn't serving the Lord. I had tried all the things that the world had to offer. Never satisfied. 10 o'clock at night, they will come in and they'll put you to bed. They say, lights out. It's time to hit the rack. Nice. Well, two click at body. Turn the lights on. Get up, get up, get up, get outside. So after I came home from Korea, my oldest sister and her husband and two children sold a house at Punchbowl and moved to California. While they was in California, they looked for a Pentecostal church and they saw a little writing, New United Pentecostal Church just started. They live in a town called Livingston. The church was in Mercier, where I was saved. And they said, we want to come, and they were the first charter member of the church. And when I came up on parole, on my leave, they told me, Benny, go to church with us tonight. So what? We want you to go to church with us tonight. I said, okay. So, like most Marines, I ironed my uniform. I what they call spit shine my shoes. You actually spit them. And we shine it. Try it, you'll like it. Got all my ribbons and my medals, you know. I want to be like a real dude, you know. There's a few of us who can be Marine now. So we go to church, all Pentecostal people, the women, the men. They dress different, they look different, they act different, they come up to do that. So praise the Lord. They don't say that in Marine Corps. And to be service started. Never been in a Pentecostal church like that. I've been in church. But I've never been in a, you see, in a Pentecostal church. The thing that makes us different is we believe in the invisible God.
Yes.
We worship Him in spirit and in truth. And brother, we give Him everything that we got when we worship, when we pray, and when we knock the Lord. I don't remember the singing. I don't remember the testimony. I don't even remember what the preaching was about. But one thing I do remember, Pastor, I felt for the first time the presence of Almighty God. And he's got a heart for the young people. I was just 20 years old. I was just a young fella. I mean, I had hair on my head. Praise the Lord. Everybody says senior citizen.
Senior citizen.
I'm what you call a senior citizen. How do you know? Take a good look at me. When I start getting bald, losing my hair, my two boys said in a nice manner, "Dad, you're getting thin on time." Interpretation, "You're getting bored." And this is what I told them. "You're going to find out one of these days when you become as old as I am, it's hard to grow grass on a busy street."
Cheaper in Texas!
in the church van, but they sent the church home. And the guy that put the gas in, fill it up. I said, no!
Changed my life.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
This is what the Bible said. In Enoch. What is Enoch? Bible said that Enoch walked with God. Come on, Enoch. Read the 5th chapter of Genesis.
Yes.
When you read all these men that lived 100, 200, 300, what is Methuselah? 969 years. It's a good thing. They didn't have Social Security back in those days. They've been bankrupt a long time ago. Enoch lived over 300 years.
Right.
Yeah. And I think 82 years old, he's just a young king and talking to those men. But this is the Bible says, every day, for 300 years, God and Enoch. He didn't belong to any church. He didn't belong to any denomination. There wasn't no Ten Commandments on my way, but somehow, someway, while he was alive, he had a relationship with the Lord. For 300 years, he walked with God. He walked with God. And finally, God told Enoch, you know what, Enoch? You've been walking with me for 200 years. Today, you don't have to go home. You just come with me. And the Bible said that Enoch walked with God, and Enoch was not, for God took him. What do you mean? God raptured him. Translated him. So regardless how many years you walk with God and I walk with God, whether we be dead or alive, what did he say? We're going to walk with God and we ain't coming back home to Hawaii. Coconut tree. I climbed around the coconut tree from being starved. There wasn't no meat back in my day. They had what they call coconut tree and macadamia. We would steal the coconut and the macadamia nut back in my day. But there's coming a day that our walk with God, regardless of you see, your relationship with God is up to you.
Amen.
Don't blame the pastor. Don't blame the saints. Don't blame the school. Don't blame the work. If you want to live for God, you can live for God.
Amen.
And nobody can stop you.
Amen.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
So, he asked me, Brother Cathedral, how long do you want to live? 90, 100. I say, I want to live as long as the Lord will allow me to live. When the Lord say, okay, you've preached long enough, and you've teach long enough, it's time for you to come home, I want to say, I'm tired.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Chapter of Genesis. The Bible tells us that Jacob, everybody say Jacob.
Jacob.
His name means deceiver. His name means supplanter. Jacob, after 20 long years, was going back home to see his brother Esau. Haven't seen him for 20 long years. They were brothers that came from the same father, who was Isaac. Jacob that stole the birthright from his brother Esau. It was Jacob that deceived his father Isaac and took the blessing that was supposed to be inherited by the oldest son, Esau, but he stole the blessing and the birthright. And after 20 long years, he's coming back home to see his brother Esau. And Pastor, he felt and he had come to the conclusion for what I did to my brother Esau. When Esau sees me, he's going to kill.
Right.
Because the last time he saw Esau 20 years ago, Esau was crying and weeping. He said, "You deceived me. You took my birthright. You took my blessing." And he said, "Someday, Jacob, when I see you, I'm going to take vengeance. I'm going to kill you." And Jacob said, "When I see brother Esau after 20 years, surely he's going to kill me." He gathered his two wives, maid servant, and all of his children together. They all hugged and kissed him, wept and cried and sent him across the river brook. And there Jacob was all by himself, thinking, what will be the outcome of the saved brother Esau tomorrow? He got in a position where you and I sometimes we don't know where to turn to when we get desperate. Sometimes we read the Bible, we can't find any consolation. Sometimes we talk to the pastor, he can't help us. Sometimes we ask all of those saints of God. Sometimes we get to the point like you and I, like Jacob, God, I don't know what tomorrow brings, Lord. But God, I need to hear from you. And God, I need a talk from you, Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there's nobody else can help, friend. Turn to Jesus. He needed a divine talk from Almighty God. Said when he went to sleep that night, he wrestled with a man. The Bible said, read Genesis, the 30th chapter. Actually, he wrestled with an angel of the Lord God himself in the form of an angelic being. Okay? He wrestled with that angel of the Lord all night. Long, that's a long wrestling man. Huh? The angel said, "Let me go." Jacob said, "I ain't gonna let you go until you bless me." When the wrestling match was over, the sun started to rise from the east. The Bible said the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint. It became this again. So the next time you see Jacob, he's walking with a limp. That's what the Bible said. He wrestled with the angel. God touches him physically. And the Lord said, "What's your name?" "My name is Jacob." God said, "I'm going to change your name. Your name's not going to be called Jacob. Your name shall be called Israel. Because you have power unto God and unto you." Nobody tried to tell him. Jesus Christ. When you have what we call the apostolic Pentecostal experience with God, God touches your life.
Right.
I said, God touches your life.
Yes. Amen.
Isn't that Jacob? Yes. What happened to you, Jacob? Did you fall off from the coconut tree? No. Did you fall down from the banyan tree? No. Were you picking mangoes? No. How come you're walking with a limp? You're not going to believe it, but I wrestle with the angel of the Lord.
Yes. Yes.
And when you encounter with the God of heaven,
yes,
and when he touches your physical body and spiritual, you walk different.
Right.
You talk different. You act different. You dress different.
Yes.
Not only that, when you get baptized, because God changed your name from Jacob to Israel.
Wow.
So when I got baptized, my name is not just Benny Osiris Coratino, but my name is Benet Osiris Coratino, Jesus Christ, because we are buried with him back there by baptism. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. It was the conclusion of Jacob's testimony. Jacob said, "For I have seen God face to face." He did not see God in the spirit, but he saw God dwelling in an angelic being that he wrestled with all night long. And when you give your heart to God, and you have this Pentecostal experience, hallelujah, it'll change your life. To make you love your wife, love your mother-in-law. You won't kick the cat or the dog, praise the Lord. You'll love everybody.
Amen.
Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I believe that God is love.
Amen.
And I don't care how bad I get, God still love for me. God bless you.
They can attest to you that I'm not lucky.
Right.
things in this flow by way, but I'm very blessed.
Yes, hallelujah.
I guarantee you, he had a shout before he even had heart conditions. He might be shouting now because what God did with him was his heart condition, but I guarantee you, if that never happened, he'd still be shouting the way he was shouting. Thank you very much for sharing your heart. I enjoy it. Yes, it's more expensive. I'm blessed.
Yes.
To look at those who have been walking. You know, this relationship is so vital.
Yes.
And 20 years old.
Yes.
And, we're going to bring our musicians up very quickly. And I'm going to ask you in this house tonight. I don't know where you are in your relationship with God.
Right.
There comes points in your lives that you need to make the decision that I am not going to leave until you bless me tonight. Some of you think you've been living for God for 20 years. That's a drop in the bucket.
Right.
Eye has not seen and ear has not heard yet.
Yes,
amen. I didn't ask him, but I guarantee if he could do it all over again, there might be some things different he would do. But this relationship with God, you've come so far and so close.
Yes.
That he is really coming to take us home one day.
Hallelujah.
I had that quick glimpse in the mind for a brief moment that that day will come that he's going to say, you know what? You don't have to go home. You come home with me today.
Right.
I want to open this altar of this wise, and even for our musicians and our singers, how do you want your relationship to be? Are you just happy because it is what it is and it's great? You know, your relationship with God can be awesome today, but there's always room to make it better tomorrow. I actually feel sorry for the people who think everything is all good, that we don't need anything better. My life, I hear what you're saying. I didn't do a lot of things in my life.
Yeah.
I thank the Lord for keeping me from that.
Yeah.
I don't regret it one single bit. Thank you for living for God for 62 years. Thank you. Maybe in Texas, all the Texans might know that many people have the privilege of hearing the stories of our elders in their 70s, 80s, 90s, and even over 100.
Yeah.
How they came to the Lord and how they were at the merger in 45 and
yeah.
How they started the church under the tree and in this town. They have all those stories, but we don't have those stories growing up. Thank you for being a testament to us.
Yes.
This is proof that even local people can live for God.
Yes.
Even if you come from high low,
yes.
You can live for God.
Amen.
I want to open this altar for every one of you. There's something inside of you that it has to be stirred to say, God, I want you to bless me. I want you to bless me, Lord. I want a greater relationship with you.
Hallelujah.
I want a relationship with you that's going to hold me until the day that you come to take me home. There is nothing like Pentecost.
Amen.
It was said at the beginning of this message that Pentecost is not a religion. It is the experience of a lifetime that will change your life.
Yes, Father.
There is no position in life that is more valuable than the experience of Pentecost.
Hallelujah.
Let's lift the hand all over this house tonight. worship you, Jesus. Do you want to experience Jesus in a greater dimension? I want to invite you to come tonight. Maybe you've got to wrestle with the Lord. I want to invite you to come and find some place in this altar tonight.
Jesus.
Find some place in this altar tonight. Jesus, I'm going to walk with you. Say, I walk with you. we have so many years left ahead of us. Sometimes in our youth, meaning in our young age, we feel like there's so many opportunities, so many things well ahead of us, and yeah, old people can live for God. But you gotta remember, you heard from a man who started living for God at 20. I'm 46 and I started living for God at 20. Not quite 62 years, but 46 is a lot of years. That was the best choice I ever made. Yeah. 20 years old. Yeah. Often I look back and I think to myself, well, Archie, God knew exactly what he was doing. I was reliving my own experience when I went to a Pentecostal church. I don't remember the singing. I don't remember who was singing. I don't remember the message. But I felt something in that house. Something that was so far that I couldn't shake it off after service. Something that even in my most strongest days of my flesh, the strongest days of myself, that I still couldn't shake off the reality of what has been transpired in that house. I often look back and I think, Sister Barbara, you may do the same.
And if God has given you
laughing today, I enjoy the laughing. And I don't think we're any less spiritual because we only read three verses of the scripture. Praise the Lord. The goodness of our life. Amen. In many ways, I'd much rather have somebody tell me about how they live for God and the evidence. Of having lived for God and this holy to me all day of something that can happen when you've ever done. I want us to stand tonight as we dismiss. This is not a letter to dismiss. I'm going to ask, you know, it's so funny they call you uncle. I almost called you uncle today, but I actually should, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, I should call you uncle. You know when you meet somebody on a certain way, it's, I'm mostly like I'm being disrespectful. I say no.
God bless you. Please meet my evangelist today. God bless you.